Today's presentation or today's talk is going to be given by Domenico Chionzo. Domenico received the BSc MSc in Computer Engineering and the PhD from the University of Campania in Italy. Since 2011, he has had several visiting appointments such as NATO CMRI IT, the ECE department at the University of Connecticut in US, CTTC, among others. His reviewing activities were recognized by the IEEE Communications Letters, IEEE Transactional Communications, IEEE Transactional Instrumentation and Measurement, and other IEEE and MDPI sensors journals. He was also nominated as the exemplary reviewer for MDPI sensors journal. Furthermore, his editorial activities have been recognized by the IEEE Communications Letters, which nominated him as the best editor in 2018 and 2019. He has served also as an associate editor for several IET journals, Elsevier and IEEE journals. Currently, he's the area editor for the IEEE Transaction of Aerospace and Electronic Systems, as well as the IEEE Communication Letters. His research interests fall within the areas of data fusion, network traffic analysis, statistical signal processing, IoT, and wireless sensor networks, as well as wireless communications. Domenico has authored more than 85 journals and conference publications that are highly reputed venues. Since 2016, he was nominated as the IEEE senior member, and he has received several awards, which includes Best Paper Awards, Exceptional Service Award, Technical Achievement Award, among others. He has served and continue to serve as an independent reviewer and evaluator of research and implementation projects and project proposals that are co-funded by EU and non-EU parties. In today's talk, Domenico is going to talk about the topics of network traffic classification and prediction generated by mobile apps. Due to the beneficial use in network management, user tailored experience and privacy will be discussed. Firstly, the reasoned use of deep learning umbrella will be introduced and explained in this context, and the lessons learned as well as common pitfalls will be highlighted. The adoption of sophisticated multi-modal multitask architecture will be put forward. The objective is to devise an AI-based traffic analysis tools that is able to capitalize the structural nature of traffic and able to support different objectives. The talk will also cover the current research done in the area of AI-based network traffic analysis at Traffic Group of the University of Naples in Italy. So at this juncture, I would like to welcome Domenico. Good afternoon, Dom.
In detail, I will first spend a few words providing the context on mobile traffic, pointing out the traffic classification and traffic prediction problems. I will then mainly focus on mobile traffic classification. I will describe some attempts for respective traffic classification based on standard methods and integration fusion of them. I will then introduce the application deep learning to mobile traffic classification, push forward the adoption of multimodal and multitask techniques to address design of classifiers which are able to deal with the heterogeneous nature of traffic and also being able to solve different traffic classification tasks associated to different desiderata. I will then focus on the issues of data availability and reproducibility and will provide the first shot on mobile traffic prediction. I will then end the presentation with some take-home messages drawn from reported findings. First thing first, why should we care about trying to do analytics for mobile traffic? The reason is that mobile traffic is and will be increasingly represent a significant share of traffic generated by devices connected to the internet. And this is also confirmed by reports done by big network players like Ericsson and Cisco. Hence, a laser-focused network management passes through the inside knowledge of such bulk of traffic. And this trend is also reflected in our everyday life. In fact, if you think about the pandemics, we are massively using collaborative apps for working and for doing remote meetings like this one. And probably while you're working, your daughter or son is in the other room, wasting your bandwidth, watching Netflix series or making debatable videos on TikTok. with these Earth smartphones. So in order to face with this composite nature of traffic, we are in need of associating the network flows being carried over the network with the mobile applications that are generating them and possibly predicting their near future 5G behavior. And this is what mobile traffic classification and prediction is about. In this talk, I will mainly focus on mobile traffic classification, but I will also provide some interesting results pertaining to traffic prediction at the end of it. Clearly, there are a number of main drivers for performing accurate and effective mobile traffic classification. Such drivers mainly pertain to two main pillars. These two pillars are network management and user profiling. Also, not to say that such distilled information may be either leveraged by infrastructure operators and advertisers for totally legit reasons, but also raise some privacy issues because of the potential issue in indiscriminate network surveillance and also obtaining some sensitive information like context-sensitive apps like dating or health apps. Of course, network traffic classification problem is not new and we are not thus reinventing the wheel. Back in old days, performing traffic classification was relatively easily performed by looking at the destination port or inspected payload of the clear text, or using both. And the issues were mainly related to the implementation efficiency aspect. Okay, so this is why in this slide I'm reporting the outcome of a national pilot made a few years ago from our group, in which we performed traffic classification by the combined use of port and payload information, and the focus was only on the complexity aspects like memory and CPU usage. Unfortunately, the situation has become dramatically worse in the last years, and now performing traffic classification of the traffic generated by these mobile devices has become quite a nightmare. For reasons. First of all, there are hundreds of applications which are currently used by mobile users. Okay, just think about the Play Store or the iOS Store. You can download whichever app you want. And each of these applications has its own peculiarity and generates a peculiar traffic. The second problem is that even with the same mobile application, depending on the type of device that you're using, the operating system you are using, the generated traffic from the same application may differ. And also the generated traffic may differ because you are using a different version of the same app. And of course, there are updates of this application like every week. So the problem is very challenging. The problem is that many applications use what are called third-party services, which are common services which are used like to perform common operation like the Google Maps APIs. And this kind of services make the identification of application very challenging and more difficult. Last but not the least, the traffic is becoming almost entirely encrypted. So just forget about doing payload inspection of this packet. And for this reason, in recent years, both the academia and the network players have been started tackling the problem of traffic classification by means of machine learning algorithms, which are based on statistical features extracted from a given aggregate of traffic. The above design is mainly based on a two-step phase in which there is a first phase in which the statistical features are designed by some domain experts. And then the statistical features are used by a proper machine learning algorithm for classification. However, this kind of two-step approach has been shown to have some serious performance limitation in the face of mobile traffic. And this is where we started from in doing this research. Simply, we started from what has been done so far. We started from what was done so far. Specifically, we were starting from a number of machine learning classifiers that were already devised for mobile traffic classification and in general encrypted traffic classification, and tried to understand whether there was some room for combining them, for integrating them, for fusing them, so as to come up with a meta classifier which had to improve and to overcome the limitation of the individual classifiers and perform hopefully better than the best classifier. In this case, we proposed a general multi-classification system which exploited a pool of different classifiers and used the outputs of these classifiers in either a hard or soft fusion way to provide a combined output. The performance of this approach has been evaluated over three different real datasets. I'm not going into the detail of these datasets, but just to let you know that two of these datasets have been provided by us, by a global mobile solution provider, and include more than 40 different applications pertaining to iOS and Android operating systems. Finally, the third dataset, which is called Facebook Messenger, is a classification dataset collected in our laboratory at the University of Naples. And this pertains to the classification of two very similar applications like Facebook and Facebook Messenger with the objective of building differentiation. Looking at the performance, it's apparent that by looking at the best machine learning classifier in this context, we were able to improve the performance of the best machine learning classifier by means of the multi-classification system proposed. The improvement was appreciable and was worse with hard combining, it was better with soft combining. But in both cases, we improved performance, but we were not able to approach what is called the Oracle performance, which is the ideal combiner classifying the actual class when at least one of the classifiers in the pool was right. Still, the performance achieved were far from satisfactory and relied on the users of classifiers based on entrusted features. So this is why we turned to the adoption of deep learning techniques to mobile traffic classification to circumvent the time-consuming and entrusted step of feature design, which becomes even more problematic and prone to be rapidly updated in the case of mobile traffic due to its phase-based evolution. This is essentially the comparison of the machine learning and the deep learning workflow, in which when you have the deep learning workflow, essentially you don't have a feature extraction step, but the feature extraction step is implicitly included in the deep learning algorithm. However, we found that the application of deep learning network traffic analytics may imply wrong design choices and lead to biased and likely over-exaggerated claims, which means that this is because essentially network traffic analysis does not map one-to-one into problems like image processing or natural language processing. In the end, attempting to solve a traffic classification task and also a traffic prediction task by directly taking the raw network traffic as a monolithic input to distill a desired behavior does not represent a wise attempt. And I will show you why in the later of this talk. Okay, and for the mentioned reason, we define a step-by-step framework for the design of deep learning-based traffic classifier and their comprehensive performance evaluation. Such framework is made up of four milestones. Okay, the first milestone is essentially associated with the choice of the so-called network traffic object, which corresponds to the kind of rules which define the aggregation criteria for the set of packets that are traversing over a network device. And we found that the most common choices were the flows and the backflows. The flows are essentially all the packets that have a common source IP and source port and destination IP and destination port, whereas the backflows are flows in which the source and destination will be exchanged. The second milestone consists in selecting the input data which fits the architecture. This is a very crucial step, and this is the main difference with respect to the application of deep learning in like image processing or natural language processing, because the inclusion of a part of the raw traffic which violates the constraints of spatial invariants may lead to inflated performance. And this is why we try to understand what has been proposed in the literature so far And we came up with essentially three different choices. The first choice is usually people are using the first n bytes of the payload of the traffic object. Other researchers have been using the informative fields of the first n p packets, like the source port, destination port, the payload length, and so on. And the third choice was like using the entire pickup raw data of each value. Okay, I'm raising a warning flag for this last kind of input because this kind of input includes some information which may identify the flow even if you're not identifying the application. The third milestone consists in the design of a specific deep learning architecture which is in charge of distilling from the provided input to the desired output, and which in this case it is the correct application which generates the traffic. Literature has shown that most of the researchers have considered both purely convolutional or recurrent architectures, and only a few attempts of hybrid compositions have been approached. The last milestone, but not the least milestone, consists in defining a comprehensive evaluation workbench which allows to delve into the fine-grained performance of these classifiers, because when you classify mobile traffic, you are dealing with the tens or even hundreds of applications. So the simple concise metrics like the accuracy and the F measure are not enough. So there is the need for a comprehensive performance workbench, which also includes and which also analyzes the per class behavior, the soft output behavior of the classifier, and the performance even in case of sensoring techniques. We considered the deep learning techniques which are proposed in the literature over the three datasets that I have introduced, and we put them in comparison to see what were the relative performance. And for completeness, we also reported the best machine learning classifier reported so far, which is a random forest based on 70 features, 70 different handcrafted features. And looking at the relative comparisons, it turns out that the best performing architectures are, however, those which include the pickup file, which is a kind of a biased input. And this kind of performance may lead to an exaggerated claim in terms of the degree of accuracy in classification that could be achieved. By removing this kind of biased input, the performance are lower, and especially while there is an improvement ranging from the 5% to 6% over the Android and iOS dataset, the deep learning approach was able to outperform the state of the art in machine learning. So there is either room for performance. Room for improvement, and or the situation that should be changed anyway. Also, by digging into the performance, into the fine-grained performance of these deep learning classifiers to look for some possibly relevant error patterns, we observed that there were no systematic error patterns, but that there was rather a class imbalance effect that was observed. And this kind of problem is a problem that you always find in the mobile traffic classification, because this depends on the fact that there are applications which are more used and then generate much more traffic and represents majority classes in your dataset. Accordingly, we were able to come up with three different considerations, which were the existing proposals only exploited one kind of traffic modality. As you may remember, I have told you that this kind of architecture were either using the payload or either using the informative fields of the packets, but none of them was using both. The second one is that many of these architectures proposed were some ad hoc architectures. And the third problem was that the class imbalance effect on the performance was very strong and was not accounted by this architecture. And this is why we came with this proposal, which is called MIMETIC, which is a catchy acronym for multimodal deep learning based mobile traffic classification, which is a general specification of a multimodal deep learning architecture for traffic classification. In detail, MIMETIC is fed in general with p different input data for each traffic object that we have to classify. And such deep network is first composed of a number of input specific layers, which allow to extract in increasingly abstract fashion the discriminative feature pertaining to a given view. And this allows to capitalize the intramodality dependence. Then the abstract features at a certain point are joined via a merge layer, which represents the first layer channeling the modality specific distilled information toward a joint multimodal representation. And finally, the architecture is completed with a few shared representation layer and the usual softmax activation layer. Of course, this kind of architecture cannot be trained from the scratch as it is, because this may lead to overspecialization toward a given modality. So we also propose entry and a suitable procedure, which is composed of two phases. These two phases are a pre-training and the fine-tuning phases. During the pre-training, each single modality stack is the first pre-trained independently, which means that the branch is trained without the shared representation layers, and each modality is topped with a softmax layer stub at this training. Then after doing the independent training for each modality, there is the fine tuning, in which the softmax stubs are removed and the training of the whole MIMETIC architecture is performed after freezing the parameters of the lower layers. During both the two phases, we are using cost-sensitive learning to analyze the classes with more samples. And this is what we are using in the experimentation, which is a specific instance of the general architecture that I have just introduced, in which we have a deep architecture, which is a multimodal, which operates at the bifurcation level, which is made of two different modalities, which capitalizes two different modalities, which are the NB bytes of the transport layer payload and the first and the formative fields of the first IP packets. And then this kind of architecture is reported and is analyzed in comparison to the deep learning architecture that were proposed so far. Looking at the performance, we have compared our MIMETIC instance against four classes of baselines. The first class is the best single modality deep learning architectures that we could identify. The second class was the state of the art in machine learning, namely the random forest, the same random forest of the earlier slides. The third one was a baseline made of shallow neural networks. And the fourth one was a simple combination, let's say, classifier fusion technique applied to the classifiers based on individual modality to understand whether doing this kind of intermediate fusion was better than doing merely late fusion. Okay, so it turns out that looking at performance, our MIMETIC architecture, our MIMETIC instance is able to outperform all these class of baselines and report up to 8.66 FF measure on the iOS dataset. And there is also some improvement on the Facebook Messenger dataset. It's not reported for the video. By looking at the fine-grained performance, by digging into the fine-grained performance, we also observed that the use of multimodality and of cost-sensitive learning allows to achieve a reduction of error patterns, which is almost uniform, and also to mitigate the unbalanced class imbalance effect, as you can see from the confusion matrix for the Facebook Messenger dataset. What's also interesting is that MIMETIC not only reaches the highest classification performance, but it also shows a lower complexity than its main competitor, which is a 1D convolutional neural network based on the SOL payload. This is highlighted by considering on the left of the slide the runtime per epoch of the training phase, and on the right the overall number of trainable parameters in number of millions, of the implemented distance of mimetic and of the considered architecture. The reason for this lower complexity is mainly due to the simple, which means computationally lighter, layers involved in mimetic instance, because this is allowed by an improved capitalization of the inputs available. Having shown that it is an effective enable for higher performance traffic classification in mobile and in general in encrypted traffic context, we have then turned our attention toward the typical requirements to be met for sophisticated network management required by next generation networks. Specifically, this relies on the accomplishment of a number of diversified network visibility tasks. This motivates the need for solving several traffic analysis tasks, therein included a number of different traffic classification tasks, each associated to a given visibility, network visibility viewpoint. And hence, in order to, to meet the above desiderata, the aforementioned task need to perform it all with a satisfactory accuracy and a reasonable complexity. And for the mentioned reason, we approach this kind of problems by the combination of multimodal learning, which was already present in Mimetic, with multitask learning. Multitask learning, on one end, is able to reduce the computational overhead because you use only one network to solve multiple traffic classification tasks instead of having n different separate networks. On the other end, this approach promises improved generalization performance and better overall classification accuracy. Based on these premises, we proposed what we have called the Distiller framework. I'm not spelling this old acronym, and which is a general approach for solving multiple traffic classification tasks while exploiting the diversity of multimodality and the regularization benefits of multitask learning. In detail, Distiller is made of three main parts. The first part is a bunch of modality-specific layers to distill the information pertaining to each modality. Then there is a number of layers for drawing the shared representation, capturing intermodality dependence. And then there is a number of task-specific layers which are specializing the shared representation toward the solution of a given specific task. Still, in order to reap the above design benefits of Distiller, there is the need of a suitable training procedure for exploring both multimodality and multitask learning. According to Distiller, it's trained by means of two-step phases where it was done for Mimetic, but with an improved addition. Indeed, during the pre-training, each single modality stack is trained to be able to solve alone all the considered traffic classification tasks. Okay. And then during fine-tuning, shared representation, task-specific layer are added to the trained dual architecture. During both pre-training and fine-tuning, in order to make each architecture be able to solve the different traffic classification tasks, this is a multi-objective optimization. This is achieved by means of what is called the Pareto scalar optimization. Okay, so this is essentially a weighted form of the objective concerning to the different tasks. We have then provided an experimental assessment for Distiller on a public dataset which is made of encrypted traffic, and we have considered three different tasks, which are essentially to ascertain whether virtual private network encapsulation is performed or not, whether which kind of traffic type is being observed, and finally, which application is generating it. So we are essentially trying to solve three different tasks simultaneously, and for doing so, we are using two different modalities. And this is on the right of the slide, you find the specific instance of Distiller, which has been employed for the numerical experimentation. Looking at the performance of Distiller of the three different considered tasks, we are able to beat all the multitask baselines proposed so far on all the three tasks. Okay, so this gain is due to the combined exploitation of the regularization property obtained by multitask learning and by using the diversity provided by multimodality. Additionally, the computational complexity of our distillery instance, which is the last column on the right, which is the measured in terms of the runtime per epoch, is quite manageable because the distiller approach is based on multimodality, so there is no need to have heavy computational layers. So in comparison to the best baseline, our distiller approach keeps a lower computational complexity. Top of that, it turns out that distiller also better suits to capitalization of its correspondent of its corresponding confidence vectors, which means that the architecture is better calibrated with respect to the best baseline. In fact, deep learning approaches usually tend to overfit and provide over optimistic confidence in their classifications. This effect is somewhat mitigated already by the use of multitask learning. But we prove herein that there is a boosting mitigation effect when multimodal and multitask learning are combined together. And indeed, the calibration diagrams, which are shown here on the top row for distiller and on the bottom row for the baseline, and by looking at column, you are seeing the different tasks, tells us that the calibration diagrams of distiller better align toward the ideal confidence accuracy line, which means that, for instance, 80% confidence roughly leads to 80% accuracy. And this is also confirmed by the Albert expected calibration error, which is the easy, which is a concise metric for assessing the deviation of the calibration diagram toward the ideal line. Although interesting, these results were either obtained on the private datasets or public datasets not explicitly contained mobile traffic. In other cases, there are public datasets, but these are bots generated, and it has been shown that bot generated traffic not always represent with accuracy the real traffic, the traffic generated by real users. For this reason, and to foster reproducibility and further advances on the topic by the scientific community, we devised and implemented the reproducible architecture for generating mobile traffic and automatically creating the associated ground truth pertaining to the mobile application that is generating it. This has led to what we have called the Mirage project. Mirage is implemented as a collection and GT generation, GT stands for ground truth generation architecture, where real users can connect their devices, their mobile devices to an USB hub, which jointly with the capture server is able to collect all the traffic generated by them and associate the right application package associated to it. The experimentation through a few hundreds of users which have come to our laboratory to collect these different applications has led to the corresponding Mirage dataset. Such dataset is named Mirage 2019, and the current version is made of 40 different Android applications which belong to different to 16 different categories from the Play Store. These applications are all labeled at the by flow level, so there is no chance that a given by flow may be labeled when it is background traffic. There are packet per packet data, per flow features and per flow metadata associated to each by flow in the dataset in the form of JSON, in a JSON format. For those of you which are interested in performing mobile traffic analytics via data-driven approaches, you may refer to the URL which is reported at the end, at the bottom of the slide, to download the Mirage dataset and perform some experimentation. Mobile traffic classification is possible with the Mirage 2019, but I would like to highlight its usage also for mobile traffic prediction, as highlighted in the current slide. Specifically, fine-grained network management requires predicting in accurate fashion peculiar features of a given traffic object, like the next packet direction, the corresponding payload size, and the differential time of arrival, for example. Unfortunately, due to the current composition of mobile app traffic, one model is not enough to predict the behavior of different applications. So one model does not fit all these phases, and there is the need for devising a predictor per application or a predictor per group of applications. Of course, this is what is the expected workflow in which you have the traffic object, which is obtained from the raw network data. The buffered packet data are both used to classify the specific application generating the traffic and triggering the specific predictor, which is a per app predictor, which gives you the right prediction in terms of packet direction, payload size, and inter-arrival time. Okay. We are currently experimenting the design of traffic of machine learning and deep learning predictors at fine grained on a number of applications provided by Mirage 19, just to exemplify that Mirage 19 is also suitable for mobile traffic prediction. And this is this slide is just to give you a bird's eye view. I have reported the results of the application of prediction on two different applications, which are Spotify and TikTok, and the use of two different predictors, like one machine learning predictor, which is the random forest, and the other one, which is a deep learning predictor, which is the convolutional neural network. I have shown the results in terms of accuracy in the prediction of the next direction and in the prediction of the next inter-arrival time and the next payload length. It turns out that results highlight quite different performance of the two approaches depending on the application, the kind of peculiar feature to be predicted. This accordingly requires a wider and deeper investigation, which are indeed currently pursuing at our group. And of course, whoever of you would like to make some progress on this topic, you can download Mirage because it is public and it can be used for design and experimentation on this task. Just to summarize, we have seen how an AI application of deep learning techniques to traffic analytics can lead to inflated performance. Hence, we have put forward the need for selecting unbiased while informative slides from traffic data. Results have highlighted that no killer deep learning architecture exists for mobile traffic classification and the need for solution which guarantee high performance and be able to accommodate several traffic classification tasks which are pertaining to different viewpoints of network management desiderata. Accordingly, we have proposed a framework for solving multiple traffic visibility tasks by means of multimodal multitask deep learning architectures. We have highlighted the need for investigating the performance of deep learning-based approach for mobile traffic classification at the fine level. And to this end, we have formalized the performance evaluation workbench, which is a fine-grained performance evaluation workbench for assessing their performance. And we also discussed the current partial lack of datasets for performing sound experimentation related to mobile traffic analytics. And to this end, we have introduced the Mirage project and the corresponding Mirage 2019 dataset, which is publicly available. And finally, we highlighted the need for the design of tailored traffic predictors toward sophisticated network management. To this end, I have reported some very preliminary results pertaining to the application of machine learning deep learning techniques on different mobile applications to come up with per app predictors. If you want to come up with and you want to deepen this topic, these are the essential references, but trust me, there are many, many very good papers from other people which have been just been published in the last 2-3 years. So this is a very brief starting point. But this is a good starting point for understanding the topic. I'm done, so I'm open to questions from the audience.
Thank you very much, Dom, for the nice presentation. And it's quite nice to see that you have a Mirage dataset that is open to the public. I hope that many people on the webinar will be interested to just check it out and play around with the Mirage
dataset. Yes, we deeply hope so.
So now it's time for the Q&A. I would like to invite my colleague Vishnu so to just go through if there are any questions or maybe some discussion around the presentation. So Vishnu, good evening.
Thanks, Thomas. And thanks, Dom, for that excellent presentation. Actually, this seems to be a very interesting topic. I mean, It is a very popular topic. This is probably the second or third talk around the same topic, which we have been having in this series. However, the approaches which each talk takes is different. So your approach is really interesting. In fact, one question is about, you mentioned about this mitigation of overfitting by using multitask learning and also a combined approach of multitask and multimodal learning.
Yeah.
How could you explain a little bit and why you are able to overcome these effects of overfitting? Could you explain a little bit more about this?
Because essentially we have the combined use of two techniques, as you were seeing. The first part is the use of multimodality. Because that this is the main difference with respect to like making other inference tasks. Network traffic, because of its nature, is composite. So you cannot just take network traffic as it is, as a monolithic input, and give this input data to a deep learning architecture, because there are many part of the network traffic which are related to different aspects. So each of these, they should be treated in a different way. Okay, so this is why there is the need of using multimodality to cope up with this kind of input. And this is the first part. Of course, the second part is motivated by two reasons, which means the use of multitask is motivated mainly by two reasons. Because whenever you have to solve different traffic inference tasks, like a prediction and a classification task, two traffic classification tasks, you may pursue two different approaches. The first one is to devise a deep learning architecture for each traffic classification or traffic prediction task. But this has the drawback of increasing the complexity, especially if you have to implement these algorithms over the device. And the second problem is that whenever you are facing two problems which are not the same but which are closely related, the fact that you are exploiting the common information of both of these may likely improve the performance, because you are looking at the same problem from a slightly different perspective. And this is why the use of multitask is both beneficial in terms of complexity, in terms of performance. So putting them together, of course, when you want to exploit the composite nature of traffic and you are faced to solve different traffic classification, traffic prediction tasks, that there is the need to use in the combined fashion multimodal deep learning and multitask deep learning. Of course, using multimodal multitask deep learning is defining an architecture which has multiple inputs and multiple outputs. But the funny fact is that you cannot just train an architecture like this as it is from the scratch, because there are serious issues related to the over-specialization of the network toward a given input. Because the network may specialize toward the strongest input. We're not retaining, we're not distilling the useful information to complement the situation awareness of the network. So this is why there is also the need for a complementary part, which is the design of a suitable training procedure, which allows you to train the multimodal deep learning network in such a way that you are using effectively the different inputs coming from the network, because otherwise you would only be achieving the performance of a single modality deep learning architecture otherwise, if you weren't training the multimodal deep learning architecture in this fashion.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yeah, I think this is one of the differentiating factors, I should say, from other approaches. It is quite interesting. There is a question Miguel is asking, what is the performance in terms of packets, number of packets classified? Do you have comparison with the traditional methods like TPI? And one of the problems is that they consume a lot of resources. Yes, I think that is true. It may require non-constrained platforms to run them. Yeah, we know about it. So what is your comment on this?
Okay, I try to recall all the questions to answer all the questions. Okay, about the DPI, there is a growing trend toward encryption. So just forget that you can use DPI to classify this kind of traffic. And this is the main reason, because the traffic classification techniques have shifted in the last 10 years from port-based and DPI-based approach to those based on machine learning and deep learning approach, which are based on statistical features. This is the first one. The second one is that you're right, there are of course, some serious hardware constraints in the implementation of this kind of networks on a given device, because this is a prototype. This experimentation has been carried out offline. So, but there are some interesting insights and there's some interesting future direction of research in which there is design of compressed neural network which may achieve the same performance as the non-compressed one and may be more suitable to be implemented in other network devices. The third question was about the number of packets classified. We do not have this information, but I could provide you this information because we usually measure the performance in terms of number of classified byflows, because we make the hypothesis that a given byflow is the packets of a given byflow are all associated to a given label, which is kind of the obvious assumption.
Thank you so much. I think that makes sense. Actually, that leads to the next question, which is whether the traffic that you use, in fact, just to step back, the other approaches which we have heard so far in this talk series actually takes aggregated traffic and maybe aggregation at different levels, at a number of users or flows level. I think you did mention similar kind of exploiting such kind of combination, maybe when you are talking about mimetic, I think so. You told about capitalization of heterogeneous traffic data. This kind of, could you tell us what level of PCAP traces that you mentioned? What kind of data, what level of data, what level of aggregation is used there? Is it at TCP level? Is it at IP level? Is it at application level? And is it aggregated at a number of users level, or is it at a gateway level? Could you tell us a little bit about it?
You still see the screen sharing, right? The architecture that we have proposed is quite general. It's independent of the type of aggregation, but we have found that most of the works we're using as the type of aggregation, the flows or the backflows, which means that you have over a given device, you are seeing packets that are arriving and that are going, and you are aggregating them based on a common tuple, which is the source port, the IP, the source IP, the source port, the destination port, and the destination IP. All the packets which have the same, this same tuple are represented as a flow. Differently, in the case of byflow, you have that even packets which have the exchange of the source IP and port and the destination IP and port are also included in the same traffic aggregate. And for our experimentation, we are using the byflows because of the fact that we can take into account the bidirectional communication between the client and the server side. Of course, there are other type of aggregations that you may conceive in traffic classification. For example, in mobile traffic classification, there has been also some proposal regarding the so-called service burst, in which there is an aggregation on the type on the type aggregation, and the aggregation is also performed at the destination type. So it's aggregated at the destination. What I would like to add is that in the case of the dataset that we have released, the fact that we are providing the information in terms of the flows and the byflows lets you doing some experimentation also on other type of aggregates which are coarser than the flows and the byflows, because the flows and the byflows are not aggregated by the destination, are not aggregated by the source. So whenever you want to aggregate by the destination, by the source, you have all the information to do that. So this is the final type of aggregation that we would provide for the dataset, but also for the experimentation for performing this kind of analysis. Of course, for example, even in the case of mobile traffic prediction, I have shown results pertaining to traffic prediction at the packet level in terms of byflows. But by using Mirage, the Mirage dataset, you could also conceive an aggregation in which you define an aggregate of packets in terms of, like, say, a window of 10 seconds, 1 second, and you may perform an experimentation according. You can also aggregate by means of the destination, because this is possible by the information that are contained in Mirage. So the answer is yes. We are using the most common and the finest type of aggregation, and the most reasonable, let me say, for especially for traffic classification, which we could use, which is that of the byflow level. But other kind of aggregations are possible, and but the kind of methodology that I have shown today, the multimodal multitask approach, is quite general and applies also to the other type of aggregation, other types of aggregation.
Thank you. That makes sense. Actually, Alex is asking a very good question. In fact, this was at the top of my head as well. Thanks, Alex. He's asking the main challenges for creating a high quality labeled traffic prediction data set. I think from your experience with Mirage, in fact, ITU faced this problem because we were organizing this challenge, and as part of the challenge, the question was, how do you provide data sets for this challenge problem statements that we have? In fact, as part of the problem statements, we had, I think, two of them, which were related to what you're talking about. Of course, the approach is different, but the similar problem statement was addressed as part of the challenge. If you need details, it's in the chat window. But coming back to the question, could you share with us some experiences, some lessons learned from creating this Mirage, especially from a traffic prediction?
First of all, the need for having data sets for making experimentation in this kind of field is necessary, is important, and it is it is a fundamental task, because we are dealing with data-driven approaches. So if we don't have data, there is no need, there is no sense in using this kind of approaches. So this is why it is fundamental to have a data set which allows you to train your algorithm and experiment your algorithm. So this is the bottom line that I want to share with you. Second one is that, of course, there is a difference between image processing and natural language processing, which there are competition, there is a data set, everyone can assess the data set, so everyone can test performance of his algorithm on the specific data set, on the specific competition. In the case of network data, there is a problem, because the problem is related to anonymization and privacy. The first problem is related to anonymization and privacy of the data. This is why in the collection of Mirage, the users were told in advance that the data they were collecting was about to be shared for research and experimentation purposes. They did not use their personal Endel devices, but the Endel devices was provided by our laboratory, and a specific account for applications like Gmail or WhatsApp and so on was created on the purpose for making that experimentation. This was the reason we were able to collect and also share this kind of data. Okay. The second thing is that the second problem is that you have to have the data, but you have to also to have a data set which is accurately annotated, which means that the ground truth is accurate with respect to the data set. In this context, we have come up with an architecture which is Mirage, which allows us to label each by flow level, which means that in this case we are not using the common trace level labeling, which means that we are collecting a trace and we are associating to all the byflows of a trace a given application. This may include also background traffic, and this may be a problem. We have this architecture which allows us to directly match each byflow to the corresponding app package that is generating it. Of course, we have released the data set, and this was the most that we could do. We cannot release, of course, the architecture, the software of the architecture, but if you want to try to attempt and to reproduce this kind of architecture, we have a companion paper, which is a paper of Mirage, which describes at the high level which are the steps, which is the setup, also the architectural setup that we have used to set up this kind of collection and ground truth generation architecture. So if someone of you is interested, you may look up on the paper and try to start from this specification to come up with another instance of Mirage or an even evolved version of Mirage architecture. But anyway, the main problem with the main problems are anonymization and privacy, and the second one is getting a good ground truth, which has been solved in our case by associating the byflow with the generic process in the operating system that was generating it.
Thank you so much. I think that matches with what we think is correct, but important learnings. I think as you correctly mentioned, this is the difference between MNIST data set for image recognition versus something which we do in the networks. I want to ask one last question, which is once again the other approaches which we have seen so far, how they perform with respect to encrypted traffic. I think one of the slides you did mention VPN and how your approach performs with VPN. But I want to ask you again, how do you see this encrypted traffic with the approach that you have? And another thing which we have seen in the other talks is about a rare spike of traffic, which really upsets the trained model. And they are not able to predict this kind of spikes in the traffic. So I want to ask you these two questions about how this approach compares with others when faced with encrypted traffic like VPN, as well as with rare spikes in the traffic. Could you please explain?
Okay, regarding the encrypted aspect of the traffic, that we all this kind of data set contain encrypted traffic. So this may contain like TLS encrypted, SSL TLS encrypted traffic. So these classifiers are able to classify even the presence of encrypted traffic. We are also in the phase of because these kind of algorithms are kind of black box algorithms. So we know that they work, but most of the times we don't know why they work. So we are also making an experimentation in order to understand why this when this is algorithm working well, or which kind of whether this works when bytes are actually encrypted, which kind of encrypting protocol is being used, if there are protocols which are harder to be recognized with respect to others. And we are doing this, we are currently doing this experimentation because we have found that this kind of algorithms work with encrypted traffic, but we want to understand what is the dynamic of inference made by this kind of approaches. The second question was about the spikes. This is a very challenging problem in mobile traffic prediction, and especially in the case of performing traffic prediction when you want to predict traffic at the aggregate level. Likely, if you use, like we were proposing, a predictor for even app or group of app instead of having one single model for all the application, may be able to match, to follow this kind of complex behavior. We are still investigating it, so I'm not sure that this may be actually the case, so I'm not sure about that. But I am quite convinced that the stepping stone toward the accurate prediction, even in the presence of spike, is performing traffic prediction at the level of the single or group of applications, because this allows you to have a given predictor which is specialized toward the traffic of a given application, so it is able to predict its behavior in a very accurate fashion, which means that whenever then you can combine the prediction from different applications, you have the aggregate traffic, and the aggregate traffic matches the predicted one. The predicted one matches the aggregate traffic. So this is my idea on that. We are currently pursuing the design of predictors which are not based on a single model, but multiple models. But this is a common trend in the research of network traffic prediction. So I'm not saying anything very new.
Thank you so much. I agree with you. I agree with you. I think that you have enough concepts right here. I think the concept of multitask and multimodal models that you described are quite good to attack this kind of spike challenge. And we look forward to seeing your solutions in near future. And also, I'm very happy to say that the Mirage datasets looks very interesting. So we look forward to working with you and talking about it later. Thank you again. And
let me add a few words if anyone wants to make experimentation of this kind of problems. You can contact us at we are the traffic group of University of Naples, and you can download Mirage and start trying to design algorithms. And if you have any questions, you can always drop an email to us. We will be happy to respond and help you. Okay.
Yes, thank you Dom, and once again, thank you for answering all the questions patiently. Over to you,
You're
Thomas.
You're welcome. It has been a pleasure, and thanks again for the invitation.
Thanks to you, Vishnu, for the Q&A session. And I would like to give a very big appreciation to our speaker today, Dom, for the wonderful talk. We are very thankful for taking time and going through all the research and work that you are doing in your research group.